at the outset, I must say that when there is a failure or a success, we must understand why we failed and why there was success. So that basic fundamental understanding is necessary. Otherwise, every time you do a flap and pray God, and then sometimes he may give you blessings, sometimes not. So we must know the reasons of success as well as failure. And I shall be dealing mostly with the clinical cases of resurfacing the lower limb defects. But at the same time, I will try to give you the whole spectrum from knee to sole. The topic is divided into three parts: choice of loco-regional flaps, combination flaps, and heel defects. We must search for the available tissue, and this is the theme of this presentation, that you visually as well as by palpation, you must see which tissue is available for a given defect. There may be several tissues available, several modalities available, then you have to search which one will be the most suitable for a given defect. So the main theme is the search for the available tissue. If you know how to search for the available tissue, many of the defects can be resurfaced quite easily. The wound is assessed by what tissue constituents are lost and what structures are exposed. They guide us in flap selection. Available modalities are muscle or myocutaneous flaps, fasciocutaneous flaps, which I will deal today, sural neurocutaneous flap, adipofacial flap, adipofacial extension of fasciocutaneous flap, I will give a glimpse of that, facial flap, split facial flap, fasciocutaneous extension of adipofacial flap, expanded fasciocutaneous flap to avoid SSG at the donor site, tenosynovial flap from the peroneus longus and brevis muscle. So I shall be mainly dealing with the fasciocutaneous flap. All these flaps can be transferred to the defect in different ways: transposition, rotation, hinge, tunneled, BY advancement, propeller flap, skeletonized perforator flap, retrograde interpolation flap. So you will see all the examples during my presentation. I start with some of the clinical cases. When there is a lateral knee defect, it may be small to look at, but it is a problem case, then you can have a combination of flap. One flap may not subside. So you must find tissue, which tissue is available. So we have raised two flaps. One, both are inferiorly based, and then transposed together so that they meet to each other and the donor site is grafted. So this defect can be easily resurfaced, keeping in mind which tissue is available. When there's an anterior knee defect in the central position, both the medial side as well as the lateral side are available to you. And here we have used a medial anterograde fasciocutaneous flap to cover the knee defect. When there's a contour defect, this contour must be filled. Otherwise, there'll be a tenting effect if you put a flap. There is likely to be. So what we do is we take an adipofacial extension of fasciocutaneous flap. This extended part is tucked underneath the distal part of the fasciocutaneous flap to fill up this contour. And then the fasciocutaneous unit is sutured around the defect margin and the wound heals, filling this contour defect. When the upper sheen is exposed, which is relatively smaller, we freshen the margin and then we Doppler it. And when we find a perforator, based on that, we do a VY advancement flap. We incise it, we visualize the perforator, and then we advance the flap to the defect. The donor site is closed primarily, and the result is suitable. When you have exposed hardware or bone, you can easily transpose an available fasciocutaneous flap. For this, you need not have much knowledge about the perforator, because this is about 1:1.5. and if you are in correct plane of under the deep fascia, this flap will survive. However, when the defect becomes larger and larger, then you have to certainly raise larger flaps to cover the defect. So this is a medium-sized defect, I would say, and then about 1:2 size flap it has been transposed and the donor site has been grafted. In such type of defect, we must understand that the whole defect need not be covered by a flap. It is this part, the exposed bony part, the sheen part, which requires a flap. This granulating area is a graftable area. So we have put a graft here, and this area we have transferred a superiorly based fasciocutaneous flap, and the donor site of the flap has been grafted. Sometimes we do a preoperative planning for such defect when we feel that an inferiorly based flap will be suitable, because the proximal part or the calf area has more tissue and therefore we have more tissue to transfer. But on the table, again, when you do planning in reverse, we feel no. Maybe a superiorly an antegrade flap based on the proximal perforators is more suitable. So we should have that flexibility, that once we have decided an inferiorly based flap on the table, we sometimes may change our plan, and then this is the result which we get. But when the defect is large, then the knowledge of the perforator and fascia and all these things are extremely important. This flap, which has been raised on the proximal perforator of the posterior tibial artery, is almost 1:4. Now, this will survive only when you have taken care of the perforator and the incorporation of the deep fascia. And this is the result. Now, when I did this case in the orthopedic OT, where they called me, they found that it is a very easy flap. But when they tried to repeat it without my knowledge, they certainly failed, half of the flap gone. Then they asked me, sir, you did it so easily, it worked, and we failed. So it is necessary to understand the rationality of these flaps. Now, in a similar defect, this is a posterior tibial based flap, and similarly, you can use a peroneal perforator based flap, antegrade, and reconstruct or resurface this defect. So these are almost 1:4 ratio. The other important aspect is when you have a semi-circumference deep scar causing distal edema, then also you can use a VY advancement flap very easily. And once you locate the perforator and you advance the flap and suture it, and the donor site is closed primarily, and this is a reasonable result after 6 months. So from here we come to here, and this is a very important aspect of what should be the dimension of the flap, what tissue is available, and how should I move. This is just to emphasize that when you have a distal leg defect, a TBI is exposed, and this is the scar. Now you must feel this scar. This is an abraded area. Otherwise, the tissue is soft, and underlying subcutaneous tissue and fascia is expected to be okay. Now that is your tactile sensation, your experience, that even from abraded flap area, you can confidently raise a flap, transpose it, and the whole flap survives. Now, when you have a middle third contour defect, the same principle. You see this blue-green line, this is the fasciocutaneous flap, and this lazy S-shaped incision is for exposure of the adipofacial extension. So this is the adipofacial extension of fasciocutaneous flap. This adipofacial extension has been tucked under the distal end of the fasciocutaneous flap, and then the flap is sutured so that the contoured defect is taken care of. Defect over the lateral malleolus or anterior ancle, when you excise this unstable ulcer, then you raise this flap from the based on the posterior tibial perforator at the distal segment. Now what is important is that this flap is a balloon shaped flap. So proximally it is very wide, and gradually towards the pedicle you narrow down. This narrowing is possible and feasible with the knowledge of the perforator, because that is the main blood supply. Now more you narrow to 2 to 3 cm, more is the flexibility to move to the defect. So narrowing of the flap has been advanced because of the knowledge of the perforators and their course. When you have a little posterior to the lateral malleolus, the problem remains the same. Based on the distal peroneal perforator, you raise a flap and totally skeletonized. Now this skeletonization allows you to rotate this flap 180 degree either clockwise or anticlockwise. But which one we will do, clockwise or anticlockwise? That depends upon under the direct vision of the lie of the perforator as you move the flap. So when you move the flap, you look at the perforator. If it is not kinked, if it is comfortable, then do that. If it is not comfortable, make it clockwise. Here comes the importance of the cadaveric dissection. So for dorsal defect, we thought that how far we can reach. Can we reach up to the head of the metatarsal? So we did a cadaveric dissection. This is the undersurface of the flap. So this shiny structure is the deep fascia. And this is the perforator, distalmost perforator of the peroneal artery. So we thought we will replicate it. Now if you look at this flap, because of this perforator, we could raise this flap. Otherwise, this is almost 1:6 in proportion. So what we did is, after having cadaveric dissection, this is the dorsal defect, we raised a flap of the same dimension, 1:6, and we sutured it, transferred it, and this intervening area either can be incised and the whole scar can be excised so that it becomes a single stage procedure. If not, like in this case, we did a peninsular flap, that means the flap was transferred over the normal intervening area, and after 3 weeks we detached it and the flap is well settled. Now when we do such flaps for the dorsum of the foot, this is the functional result. Hello?
Okay.
Is it okay? Am I audible? Is it okay?
Yes sir, very much audible, sir.
Right. So when we move it to the dorsum of the foot, this is just to emphasize the functional result. So there is complete plantar flexion and dorsiflexion, and this is the flap, and that's the donor side. It's a very large flap covering almost half, more than half of the dorsum of the foot. Now when you have a medial malleolar defect, you can raise a flap based on the posterior tibial artery distal perforators, and the flap initially gets swelled up and later on it settles. Now this is the importance of the knowledge of perforators. When there is a heel defect along with the tendo-Achilles area, we raise a flap based on the posterior tibial artery distal perforators. Now again you can see that this is totally skeletonized, based only connection are the perforators. The whole flap is a very wide flap with a narrow base. The important thing which I would like to emphasize is that when you do skeletonization, do not always focus on a large perforator. Do respect the smaller adjacent perforators. Everybody contributes to the circulation. So if it is not necessary to divide the smaller perforators, keep them along with the main perforator. This shows that this is an intraoperative fluorescent study. We inject the fluorescent dye systematically, and then after 20 minutes under the ultraviolet light, when we visualize the flap, and if the dye reaches up to the distalmost part, this yellowish dye, That means it has gone through the circulation. This is an intraoperative assessment of the adequate perfusion of the flap. So this flap is safe. We know it. And therefore we transferred it, and this is the long-term result. Similarly, that was on the posterior tibial distal perforator. When you have a lateral malleolar or supraheel area, this area was excised, and then based on the distal peroneal perforator, totally skeletonized, we transferred this flap 180 degree, and that's the result. Again, whether we move it clockwise and anti-clockwise depends upon the direct visualization of the lie of the perforator. On the same principle, we do the propeller flap. So it is nothing but a skeletonized perforator flap only. Only thing is that the design is little different so that we can close the donor site primarily. Then we come more distally, the heel and almost half of the sole. When such large defects are there, we plan either posterior tibial or peroneal perforator based flap. Again, it is a peninsular flap, or you can incise in between area to make it one stage. Here it is peninsular. And after 3 weeks, we detached it, and then gradually the flap settles, and that is how he is rehabilitated. Now this video shows that this is the heel defect, and we do a planning in reverse, and then make the incision 1 centimeter beyond your planned area. Why not to add 1 centimeter more? Because of tissue retraction. And then we bevel the incision so that more amount of deep fascia is included. As we dissect the flap, we come across sizable musculocutaneous perforators over the gastrocnemius. We sever them, and I always ligate towards the flap side. I do not use diathermy on the flap side. I'm very careful about it. So I will always ligate on that side, and on the muscle side, I will diathermize. So another sizable perforator, apparently it looks to be more than 2 millimeter internal diameter. Again, we divide it. These perforators are to be severed and then ligated on the flap side. And then we use, this is a 3-0 chromic catgut. And then the deep fascia is sutured to the dermis interruptedly so that it prevents the shearing movement between the segments of the flap, that is the skin, subcutaneous tissue, and deep fascia. So this shining structure is the deep fascia. And once we have done that, according to our planning, this is the perforator on which we are basing this flap. This has to be protected very well, and this allows perfusion of the flap adequately, and it reaches after transferring 180 degree rotation. And you can see the distal bleeding that must be ensured and demonstrated to your assistants. And then you suture the flap and take a nice graft. About this graft, I will talk to you later. So many a times there may be, you know, distally based retrograde fasciocutaneous flap family in the ward. There's so many cases done simultaneously. Sural neurocutaneous flap is quite useful flap for mainly for the heel defects and the adjacent area. But here the pedicle is the adipofacial unit. So this is the flap which has been transferred. That area has been grafted. Adipofacial donor site closed primarily. And this is the flap which is well set. Now at this juncture, I would create a controversy. When we move this flap, constituent wise it's different because of adipofacial pedicle. But this is also based on the peroneal distal perforator around 5 centimeter from the tip of lateral malleolus. At the same time, we are sacrificing the sural nerve, causing disability at the lateral border of the foot. There may be sensory disability. It is said that, and it is true, that the vascular plexus around the nerve is to be incorporated for successful transfer. But just now I have shown you that even without sacrifice of the sural nerve, larger flap based on the same perforator can be used. So this contradictory things always remain, and it is scientific. For larger defect of the heel extending to the sole, when we raise the flap, we find many perforators. But most of the proximal perforators are to be severed, otherwise the flap cannot reach the defect. So depending upon which perforator is more powerful, more robust, more larger in internal diameter, we decide and we can sever the rest of the perforators so that the flap reaches comfortably to the defect, and this is the post-op result. When the whole sole is required to be resurfaced, we should not neglect or disregard cross leg flap. I have visited many centers where free flap is also done, but there I have seen cross leg flap is also done. So I don't think cross leg flap will ever be obsolete, just like groin flap. So when we raise a distally based fasciocutaneous flap, a cross leg flap, suture it proximally, almost 60% to 70% inset is there, and then when we detach the pedicle, that covers this area. So almost whole of the sole can be covered by a retrograde cross leg fasciocutaneous flap. So the importance is that when we make the pedicle transverse, then this sort of transfer becomes difficult. But when it is a retrograde flap with a wider area, proximal area, that will cover almost whole of the sole very easily. And the primary inserting is also almost 60 to 70%. So the flap is very safe. This is just an example that this area has been resurfaced by retrograde fasciocutaneous flap based on the posterior tibial, and this is the cross leg flap. So this is a combination of cross leg and retrograde fasciocutaneous. Many a times there may be problem in the follow-up when these patients do not follow your instruction. There may be callosities, there may be ulcerations, there may be pressure segments which may cause again non-healing ulcer. So we always teach these patients how to take care, and if they fail, there will be problem. Simple points make the difference between success and failure. Meticulous dissection, 3 to 4x magnification is enough. Perforator need not be totally skeletonized all the time. Strands of adipose tissue or fibrous tissue should be kept even when you are skeletonizing. Lie of the perforator should be visualized prior to inserting of the flap. Prerequisites: non-traumatized tissue, non-radiated tissue, available dimension is there, and audio Doppler is very useful. Limitations: high velocity trauma, muscle damage. Muscle damage means when the force has gone from outside in, that means it has damaged the skin, subcutaneous tissue, fascia, and then muscle. Therefore, when you see the muscle is damaged, that means the structures above it must have been also damaged. Same factor is with the compound fracture. If the adjacent area is traumatized, we feel it, then we should not use this. And when the defect is very large, what are the pitfalls? There are three P's: poor planning, poor execution, and poor postoperative care. In poor planning, ignoring the applied vascular anatomy, which I did when I saw the publication of Ponton in 1982-81, and I thought it is very useful and very simple. So without having any knowledge of the vascular anatomy or the vascular axis, I did it and my whole flap failed. I have preserved that photograph very carefully because that initiated my research why it failed, and which went on for 4 decades. So ignoring the applied vascular anatomy, not knowing the safe limit of the flap, and if it is a short flap, poor planning, then there will be tension on suturing. Poor execution, wrong plane of dissection. We must identify the subfacial plane through the beveled incision from the beginning so that you do not lose the plane. Poor tissue handling, inadequate hemostasis, inserting under tension, tight dressing. Poor postoperative care, if you have done a flap and if you fail to inspect it daily, or there's limb elevation is not proper, or there is infection, then your well-executed flap may also fail. What are the advantages? It is a reliable, having a reliable vascularity, provides stable and pliable soft tissue, minimal donor site morbidity, allows tendon gliding underneath, does not require any special setup or training. Future surgery can be performed through the flap, simple and rapid procedure, easy post-op care, applicable in acute as well as chronic wounds. External fixators does not preclude their use. Even in the presence of external fixator, we have used several. Now I come to another aspect of these fasciocutaneous flaps. It is a combination of flap. When one flap is not sufficient, what to do? Or the wound is very large. Wound of different dimensions, exposing underlying vital structures like bones, tendons, or fixation plates are encountered from knee to foot following trauma, post-operative, and post-infective complications. For resurfacing the larger wounds or skip lesions, there is always a dilemma whether to use local flap or free flap. In case the free tissue transfer is not feasible, or if a single local flap is not sufficient, then such defects can be easily resurfaced by combination flaps in a single stage. Sometimes they may be indicated as a secondary procedure when the previous flap has been inadequate. These procedures can be performed for acute as well as chronic defects. The important aspect is to calculate the dimension of the defect and decide the constitution of the flaps as per the available tissue. We have used 2 flaps, but it can be more than that if need be. The 2 flaps need not be of the same size, but they will obviously approximate it together except in skip lesions. It involves imagination of the 2 flaps, dexterity of utilizing available local tissue. The combination could be of different tissue constituents or variable vascularity. It can be proximal or distal perforator based flaps of the same vessel or of different vascular trunks. It can be unilateral or bilateral. I'll show you all the examples. Thus, it can be 2 fasciocutaneous flaps, combination of muscle and fasciocutaneous flaps, 2 muscle flaps, adipofacial and fasciocutaneous flaps, adipofacial extension of fasciocutaneous flaps, which I have already shown, split fascial flap, and bilateral flaps. So wounds of different levels exposing vital structures, we frequently encounter these wounds, especially from orthopedics. So there may be composite wound defects from knee to ankle and sole of different sizes, and underlying structures may be plates, exposed plates, or bones and tendons. So exposed plates can be at the knee level or proximal shin area, or even distally, it all can be there. There may be skip lesions. See, the plate has been exposed at 3 places. I'll come to this case again. And there may be, because of infection, distal plate is exposed, hardware is exposed here. So at different level, we frequently encounter. What are the causes? The reasons are, soft tissue trauma, underestimation of viable soft tissue, improper approach to fracture site, inadequate closure, and infection. Flaps used to resurface can be anterograde for the upper third and middle third defects, or retrograde flap for middle and lower third defect. You can understand that the middle third can be resurfaced either anterograde or retrograde depending upon the availability of tissue, which I was emphasizing. This is again a repetition. This is a combination of two flaps. That's why I put this slide again. So the two flaps have been sutured together to resurface this defect. So one flap was not adequate. In this particular case, the hardware and bone is exposed here as well as here. So based on this pedicle, we designed one flap here and one flap there. So based on a single pedicle, we have dissected two flaps, combination of two flaps based on same perforator, which has been dissected and transferred very adequately. This is another defect at the sheen, where medial head of gastrocnemius and medial fasciocutaneous flap has been used. So what has been done? The fasciocutaneous flap has been dissected, the muscle has been exposed, then the muscle is dissected and transferred to the distal part of the defect, and the proximal part of the defect has been covered by fasciocutaneous flap. So it is a combination of muscle and fasciocutaneous flap. Similarly, medial head of gastrocnemius muscle and lateral inferiorly based fasciocutaneous flap. So the muscle covers 2/3 of the segment, and the distal fasciocutaneous flap covers the distal third of the segment. So there's a union of the muscle flap and the fasciocutaneous flap. When you have a defect, large defect like this, after sequestrectomy, lateral anterograde flap and medial retrograde flap. So a combination of two flaps, one medial, one lateral, one peroneal based flap, one posterior tibial based flap. So only thing what I have done is we have searched the tissue. So search the tissue, you will have a combination flap to cover last defects. As I said earlier, this is one flap and this is another flap. The dimension of the two flaps are different. It need not be of the same dimension. One may be larger, one may be smaller, but they will unite together. But on the contrary, in a case of skip lesions, they will not unite. So when in the case of skip lesion, the intervening skin is available to us. So based on the posterior tibial perforator, proximal perforator based anterograde flap and distal perforator based retrograde flap has been raised, and they have been transposed to the defect, and all the defects of the skip lesions has been covered adequately. The donor site has been covered with a slit syndrome. Similarly, lateral retrograde flap and medial anti-superiorly based flap. So in the distal part of the leg where the plate is exposed, here we have used a lateral retrograde and a medial superiorly based fasciocutaneous flap. So these are the two combination of these two flaps covers the wound very nicely. Similarly, when you have a plate exposed like this, you have to search for the tissue. So again, we have used a lateral anterograde and a medial retrograde flap. So the lateral anterograde and medial retrograde flap covers this hardware. So large defect like this can also be resurfaced. You can see the two, one superiorly based and one inferiorly based flap has been used to cover this very large defect involving the middle third and lower third of the leg. And many a times, if you have a chance, you can do a bilateral, medial and lateral inferiorly based flap. Both are inferiorly based flaps. Both are fasciocutaneous flaps. Now we come to the heel defect. See, in this type of cases, when there is bilateral amputation because of train accident, the heel was to be reconstructed. And we have used an inferiorly based fasciocutaneous flap on both sides, one on posterior tibial perforator, one on peroneal perforator. And then the flaps were interpolated like this. The whole flap survives. And after 3 weeks, you detach it. The pedicle goes back to the donor site and the patient is well rehabilitated. So this type of cases, you can use bilateral flaps, one on one vascular axis, other is on other vascular axis. The perforators are different of different axis. This I am repeating again, because this is again for the heel. The whole heel and the sole can be reconstructed by a retrograde fasciocutaneous flap and a cross leg fasciocutaneous flap. Now, heel is posterior one-third of the weight-bearing plantar area of the foot. Heel bones form the longitudinal arch of the foot. Posterior heel surface provides insertion to the Achilles tendon. It has two arches, the foot, the longitudinal and transverse. The longitudinal also have medial and lateral, and the transverse has anterior transverse and posterior transverse. These are important aspects to understand, because when we give a flap, the ultimate function will depend upon these arches also. The causes of heel defect can be trauma, pressure sore, trophic ulcer, tumor excision, post-infective, post-lymphedema, post-diabetic or post-burn. Types of defects: it can be total avulsion extending up to the sole, or avulsion only of the heel, or partial avulsion of the heel, deep trophic ulcers with overhanging margins with or without exposed bones. Now, these are the variable defects. This is the almost total avulsion of the heel extending up to the sole, only up to the heel. Partial avulsion, this tissue can be brought down to the weight-bearing area of the heel, and trophic ulcers with overhanging tissue exposing the underlying structures. The problems are weight-bearing area, the heel, limited availability of soft tissue for the heel, exposed bone, joints and tendons, repeated soft tissue infection, osteomyelitis, and poor skin elasticity. The skin doesn't move very easily. The criteria for ideal heel reconstruction is that it should be durable with adequate padding, normal joint excursion, adequate sensation, most importantly, non-hair bearing skin, filling the contour defect, and minimal donor side morbidity. It should be well vascularized tissue with adequate bulk. The contour and sensation must be maintained. Functional outcome should be adequate with good aesthetic result. Reconstructive options: split thickness skin graft, local flaps, muscle flaps, regional flaps, and free tissue transfer. What should be the constituents of the flap? Sole skin is ideal, but that is absolutely critical. There is no other skin like sole skin or palm skin. So if the local tissue can be moved, defect is smaller, that is ideal. Then comes the fasciocutaneous flap, then muscle flap, free or pedicled, with skin graft. What constituents of flap are not preferred on the sole? One is adipofacial, facial, and skin graft, because they will not withstand the wear and tear, and therefore if we put a skin graft, there will be repeated breakdown and there will be perpetual problem. What flaps are useful depending upon the dimension of the defect? If we talk only of the sole, the tissues from the sole itself, then rotation flap, VY advancement, transposition, biload flap, medial plantar artery insert flap. Muscles of the superficial layer of the sole, that is the abductor digiti minimi, flexor digitorum brevis, and abductor hallucis. These are dispensable muscles. And when we hinge this flap or turn over these flaps and suture to the defect, and then we put a skin graft, they are very useful for the heel defects. What flaps are useful depending upon if the dimension is larger? So there's a retrograde fasciocutaneous flaps, based on the distal perforators of the posterior tibial or peroneal vessels, skeletonized perforator flaps, some of the results I have shown just now, sural neurocutaneous flaps, cross-leg flaps, and free flaps. So how to go about it, the choice of resurfacing? When it's a non-bearing area of the posterior heel, then if it is superficial, put a skin graft. If it is deep down to fascia, still you can put a skin graft. Very deep, bone is involved, muscle flap with a graft. Large defect, then free tissue transfer. For inset, you can put a skin graft, that means non-weight-bearing area. In the weight-bearing surface of the plantar heel, if it is superficial, you can put a skin graft. But if it is deep down to the bone with a circumferential width of the heel pad, local arteriolar skin flap or regional flap, that is from the sole, fasciocutaneous or muscle flap or free flap. So we, amongst these, we have to assess which one will be suitable for a particular defect. The assessment of the wound is very essential. When the heel is avulsed, does not always mean that this tissue is non-viable. If it is a viable tissue, then if you can pull it up and bring it to the weight-bearing area, that is ideal. Rest of the area, you can graft it. So this flap can be advanced to the weight-bearing area. But always you are not lucky that much. If it is a partial avulsion, again you can do the same thing. This part avulsed heel, which is distally avulsed, it can be advanced to the weight-bearing area and rest can be grafted. When the wound is like this, it's not too big, you can plan a VY advancement. This is ideal because this is a sole skin, so repaired by the sole skin itself, or you can use a rotation flap. So a classical rotation flap. Why I have included it in the fasciocutaneous unit is that it is advisable to include the plantar fascia with this skin. So that is why I have included in my talk of fasciocutaneous flap. And when this flap is rotated like this, the wound heals very nicely. The planning can be like this, or it can be a planning like this. This is a rotation cum advancement flap, again a fasciocutaneous flap, and this takes care of the wound. Now when it is part of it is weight bearing and part of it is non-weight bearing, we can plan a flap like this based on the distal perforator of the peroneal artery, and this is rotated plus transported. So transposition cum rotation flap, and this heals the wound very nicely. Now, when we have a defect like this on the heel, so this, when we use a distal posterior tibial perforator based flap, this is a posterior perforator based flap, you can see how much it has been narrowed down so that the flap reaches easily to the defect. And this is the contour of the heel after reconstruction as compared to the other side. It's not bad, it's quite reasonable. And the flap edema gradually subsides. So when the defect extends from the heel up to the midsole, same distal perforator based flaps can be used to resurface such large defects. Here also you can see it's an interpolation flap. That means there is intervening tissue over which the pedicle is moving to take this tissue here. And then this is detached after 3 to 4 weeks, usually 3 weeks, and the pedicle goes back to the donor site. Details of the distal perforator flap. Now, it is important for the postgraduates to know that when we have a defect on the heel like this, so we draw the vascular axis, this red line, and then we do a planning in reverse, in which this green area is actually the area which is going to cover the defect. And the rest of the area is the pedicle which will cross over this intervening area. So when you calculate the length and width, so you have to calculate the defect, the intervening area, equal amount is the pedicle, and then the flap which will cover the defect. Same thing has been done here based on the distal perforator of the posterior tibial artery, which you can see here. This shining structure is the deep fascia, which has been tucked to the dermis with interrupted stitches to prevent shearing between the constituents of the flap. And then it is rotated 180 degree. As I said earlier, such flap can rotate clockwise or anti-clockwise. You see the lie of the perforator and then you transfer the tissue. Once you transfer the tissue, immediate post-op there will be edema because there is venous congestion as well as there is lymphatic inadequate drainage. So this is the normal, as we say, this is the right one, although there are amputated toes here, and this is the size, the left heel which we are reconstructing. So after reconstruction, how do we assess? After 3 months, this flap we are assessing by a line drawn between the weight-bearing area and non-weight-bearing area. So above this line is the non-weight-bearing area. You can compare here with the normal side. About 5 cm is the non-weight-bearing area and rest about 7 cm is the weight-bearing area. So this 7 cm, this is the normal side and this is the flap. And I have put my finger here just to show that beyond this is the non-weight-bearing area, the above 5 cm, and distal to that 7 cm is the weight-bearing area. The simple way to further assess the flap is that you take the impression. Any dye you can put on the sole and ask the patient to stand on a paper. So this is the left side and this is the right side and this is the left side. So on the left side we have put the flap here and right side is supposed to be normal. So when you compare the left, the right and the left, the reconstructed and the normal side, it's more or less matching. If we do a CT angiography, what will happen? Just for interest check, I have included this, that this is the perforator which was going, this is the distal perforator which was supposed to go like that. Now based on that we have transferred the flap, so the vessel has turned along with the flap, so the direction of the perforator has changed, the length of the perforators has increased, the diameter, internal diameter of the perforator has increased. Why all these things have happened? It is nothing but because of the delay effect. This is what we do in delay. So when we are incising 3 sides of a flap for dissecting the flap and when we transfer, it is nothing but a delay. So the effect of delay will be there on the vessel, and therefore when we do an angiography, we can see, trace this perforator. This perforator normally would have come up to here, but it has become longitudinally oriented. It might have been oblique earlier. So longitudinally oriented, the length has increased, the internal diameter has increased. That is the effect of delay. So in summary, judiciously selected loco-regional flaps can manage substantial number of moderate-sized defects. Other modalities should be used where local tissue is traumatized or the defect is large. If feasible, use simple technique like I have described. If indicated, don't hesitate to use complex procedures. Through this presentation, I have tried to illustrate that various types of fasciocutaneous flaps at various level. You have to understand what tissue is available, feel the tissue, visualize the tissue, think of all the modalities of treatment, all the tissue constituents, and whatever is best suitable for a particular given defect should be applicable. And because as I said, I have been asked to talk only on fasciocutaneous flap, otherwise I would have covered all other constituents of flap simultaneously, but that would have become very last topic. Therefore, I feel that in your orchestra, if you have all the instruments, you can produce nice melody of any tune of anywhere in the world to the best of the suitability of the audience. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir, because it was such an awesome presentation. It was such a beautiful presentation. I think I have not seen this many varieties of fasciocutaneous flaps. I think the entire fasciocutaneous flaps was covered by you, sir. Thank you very much for that. So the question to you was, sir, when you actually take in the fasciocutaneous flaps, retrograde fasciocutaneous flaps for covering the heel and other defects, you have actually shown how beautifully you are actually making the end of the flap very thin, and the distal end is quite broad, almost like a fan. So my question is, how much do you actually thin the base of the flap? One. Number
you
two.
Mean, you mean how much we narrow down the flap?
Narrow down, correct, sir.
Narrow
yes,
down
sir.
The pedicle.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So it is practically, because once you have seen the perforator and you are sure that you have incorporated the perforator at your base, so we narrow down 3 to 4 centimeters.
3 to 4 centimeters. Okay, sir. Second thing
so
is
that will allow you 180 degree rotation very easily, okay, whether it is clockwise or anti-clockwise.
Okay, sir. Second question was, sir, like many of us actually been trained to actually raise, like even though the skin is in a triangle kind of area, but we would actually take the subcutaneous tissue more vertically down so that we incorporate a lot of the superficial veins in that, veins and probably lymphatics also in that, hoping that the venous return is better for the flap. Is there any logic in doing that, or you feel that is not required?
I think that is not required, because once you are making a beveling incision where the deep fascia contracts to the level of subcutaneous tissue, that contracts to the level of dermis and then to the skin. So all becomes in one plane. On the top of that, we put the interrupted stitches from deep fascia to the dermis so that there is no shearing movement. So having doing all these cases in this fashion, immediate there will be distal edema. Venous drainage will be inadequate because the tissue was not used to that small pedicle. Gradually the lymphatic drainage and the venous drainage improves. And because especially on the pressure bearing area, with the pressure itself also causes lot of compression effect and it propels the tissue fluid. So but that will happen in any pedicle flap when you transfer, because you are cutting on three sides. So you are cutting the communicating channels.
Yes, got it, sir. Is there any tricks that you do to actually decrease the lymphedema, sir? And do you ask the patient to actually, once it is healed, do you ask them to actually massage the flap or something like that?
Yes, I tell them to massage. I tell them to use pressure garments and little limb elevation. And actually, it is quite difficult to convince them many a times. But if you tell them that if you do it for 1 week, you feel the improvement, and you insist upon it, then many of them will do it. Many of them will not.
So another question by Dr. Ravi Kumar is, do the patients have post-operative edema, lymphedema, when you take two fasciocutaneous flaps, which almost involves the whole circumference of the leg?
I have not witnessed distal edema or lymphedema effect, because the deep venous system is there. We are playing with the superficial venous system, superficial lymphatic system. So the deep venous system and the deep lymphatic system takes care of it. I have not witnessed any distal lymphedema following combination flap usefully.
Okay,
when I have used.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for the wonderful presentation, sir.